The very nature of work is changing. In some professions, it's how we work and when we work. Increasingly, it's also where we work that has undergone a major transformation in just a few years. Since millions worked remotely during the COVID-19 pandemic, it's become clear that not everyone needs to work face-to-face constantly with teams. So, if they could work effectively from home, could they work effectively from anywhere? Some companies, like global travel company Airbnb, think so. They recently announced its talent pool would have a work-from-anywhere policy, with several piloting programs to attract digital nomads to their workforce. AGSM's Business of Leadership podcast host, Professor Nick Wailes, Senior Deputy Dean and Director of the Australian Graduate School of Management at UNSW Business School, caught up with Susan Wheeldon, Airbnb's Country Manager for Australia and New Zealand, and AGSM MBA. They discussed why Airbnb sees benefits in the work from anywhere philosophy and what they have learned about working with digital nomads so far. We also talked to Will Felps, an associate professor at the School of Management and Governance at UNSW Business School, about his research into how companies can use human resource management and motivation to build a culture that gets the best out of and retains talented employees.
Hi, everybody. My name's Nick Wheeldon, and I'm the director of AGSM. Welcome to the Business of Leadership podcast series, where we're looking today at the changing nature of work. And I've got two fantastic guests joining me. Susan Wheeldon is Airbnb's country manager for Australia and New Zealand, and a graduate of AGSM. Susan, fantastic to have you here.
Thank you so much for having me, Nick. I'm excited to join.
And also joining us is Associate Professor Will Felps. Will's a researcher and a teacher in the School of Management and Governance at the UNSW Business School. Great to have you here, Will.
Yeah, looking forward to it. Thanks.
So, Susan, I thought we might start with you. We're going to explore the changing nature of work and particularly the changing nature of where work's done. So, Airbnb famously decided recently that its workforce could work from anywhere. I wonder if you could talk us through that decision and how that's played out for your business.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's what I love about it is it's one of the the world's leading, I guess, live and work anywhere. We refer to it internally as LAWA because we love an acronym. But one of the things that I think was we'd all been working from home for such a period of time. And the first question that everyone asks is, well, what happens to productivity? And what we saw was during that time of working from home with COVID, it's the same time that we IPO'd. We released 150 products in some of our twice annual releases. So it was obvious that this was a way it could work. So what Airbnb actually announced was you could choose to work from home or the office. So we've maintained all of our office space, understanding that different people have different work needs. You can move anywhere in the country that you were employed in. But what's amazing about this is you can take your salary with you. So I can go from Sydney to Stanthorpe and take a Sydney salary with me. So it really allows people to choose where they want to live and base their life. And we obviously still need to connect. So part of the tenet is that we will regularly connect across the region and across the broader world to make sure that you can continue to keep that culture up. But to give you some insight into how well that was received, when that was announced publicly, it was just over 1 million people in the first week hit our careers page on Airbnb. So it goes to show that it was a popular program and one that it'd be interesting to see how many other tech companies follow suit and continue to do that.
And Susan, it's been running for a while now. What's the balance of people working from home, working in the office, and how's that changing over time?
You're absolutely right. It does change and it changes week to week. And that's purely because of how people choose to spend their days. So it may be that if you've got to do a childcare run on certain days, you tend to work from home from there. We tend to get people all together in the office when we have what we call affinity groups. So we have team activities. So that tends to get a larger group of people into the office as well. So it's one that, it constantly ebbs and flows. But that's the joy of the program is it allows people to be in complete control of how they want to live and work.
Well, you've been researching work and effective teamwork for a long time. And I know you've been tracking the growth of work from home and some of the things that get in the way of it. When you hear stories like this, what's your reaction to it?
Well, broadly, this seems like a sort of good news story, the possibility in particular to work from home. that's something that was a trend that's been going for a while, but just creeped up, you know, year by year, little by little. So, you know, starting in the 1980s, people were talking about, oh, we're going to be able to work from home. But it didn't really manifest really until the COVID-19 pandemic, which sort of forced people to shift to a model where we can collectively figure out how we're going to actually do this thing. And then I don't think we're ever going to go back. And that shift is mainly a positive one, I think, for both employers and employees. The employees that choose to do this see a benefit. If you ask them, do I want to go back? Almost none of them do. In fact, there was a recent survey of Australians who worked from home and said, if you had to go back tomorrow, what would you do? And a third of them said, I'd quit. So basically, I think that this is becoming, at least for white collar workers, the new normal.
On another one of these podcasts, we looked at the future of the office. And some of the things about that was quite a lot of benefit of people coming together and the social interaction becoming the real value of the office. Susan, I'm wondering if you're thinking about the office differently in this new world of work and the role that it plays.
So you're exactly right. The office still does play an important role. And that's just not because of bringing everyone together, which is a core component of it. It's also, if you're starting out in your career and you're in a share house with four other people who are working from home, that's not a great environment to be in. So it allows people to be able to come in and use that space. But it does mean you have to think about how that space is set up. So previously, where it may have been, you know, what is the maximum number of desks we can fit into this space? Now it's more about people are going to come in to share and to partner together on programs. So how do you make that space, for want of a better word, more interactive? So more kind of breakout spaces as opposed to this is just hard and fast desks. So I think it does change the actual structure that you take. And then it's also about just looking at what are the reasons that people would want to come into the office, and whether that's, you know, providing lunch, end of trip facilities, you know, those type of things, just to also give people a reason to come in and connect as well.
But I presume if you don't know in advance which part of your workforce is going to be where, you have to think about what's the right system to manage it. So what are the structures that you have in place to allow people to be able to effectively work with each other when they're remote and when they're working from anywhere?
So there's a couple of things, and it is all around that management space. So some of them are things like we actually have where you book your desk. So we run a hot desk, as a lot of tech companies do. So you can see how many people are coming in each day because they've booked that desk. It also allows them to book a desk in any Airbnb office around the world. So you kind of know what your numbers are going to be. So if we have people from New York out in Sydney, we know that they're going to take X number of desks for however long. The other thing I think as well is you just also have a really strong team calendar. So you can also then use that, so people can understand who's going to be in when. And it also works to how we structure our events. So we run a 12-month calendar in advance with all of what we would call our cultural events. And that allows anyone who's living in Coffs Harbour or who's living in WA to understand, oh, on this Thursday, we're going to have this team activity. So my team will get together on the Friday. I can plan my travel now to come to those events. So it just gives people advance notice. It does require a bit of a change to how you've normally done things, but we've been doing that now for well over a year and it's working really well.
And well, I've been reading some of your work. You've done quite a lot of work on virtual teams, and it seems that structure is quite an important part of that. Do you want to talk to that a little bit more?
Sure. So whereas in a face-to-face context, you might have spontaneous interactions to coordinate with each other, in a virtual world, you have to be more structured. It requires more intention. It requires more planning. I think Susan gave a great example of that, where you sort of have a year in advance when and where things are going to be done. Yeah, you basically need more structure, you know, more project management. You can't rely on the water cooler conversations or dropping by someone's office to make things happen.
Some people say that structure gets in the way of innovation, or it gets in the way of idea generation. Do you think that's true?
I think by structure, I don't necessarily mean top-down plans for how you were going to do everything. For example, I think sometimes you need to structure for spontaneity, right? So if we're talking about how people are going to come up with ideas, that oftentimes historically has happened through sort of conversations around the water cooler over lunch. If you're not having those water cooler conversations, well, then you need to basically use some sort of technology to allow for spontaneous, non-directed conversations. So for example, there are platforms where you can go in and interact with a variety of different people somewhat spontaneously. Like for example, in my class, we use something called Toucan. And you need to plan for that spontaneity to be able to emerge in a way that you didn't before. So I guess I would say you absolutely still need the spontaneity, but you have to plan for it.
Susan, when you think about team processes or the way that people work together, how do you preserve the innovation when you've got people spread all over the place?
I think I really like what Will touched on before, which is you almost do need to plan for that spontaneous innovation. And there's a couple of ways that we do that. One is something that we have that's called affinity groups. And that is a whole range of cultural groups that have an alignment. So there's Air Pride, for example, or there's Women At. And what those groups actually do is they bring cross-functional teams together. So you get to work with people that you might not normally. And just through those type of things, you end up having conversations about what you're working on and what other things are happening. So I think that's one way. The other way is really making sure that in our all hands that you're covering off every function. So everyone is across what every other function is working on. And we're very open with the information that we share with everyone. There's a real element of trust through that. And that then means that people can understand and go, oh, hang on, you said you're working on that product. That sounds very similar to this other thing that I'd like to do over here. Can we connect offline and chat about that? So you just find other ways of being able to deliver that through. And I think the final thing that that happens is when you have those cultural events and you bring everyone together, by getting them in the office, people will normally come for a half-day event. They'll normally come in for the full day. And so, again, you're getting a large group of the team together who've then got that time in the office. And a lot of that is then around shared lunches and just kind of getting some time together, which allows that innovation to take place.
Yeah, so I think that is a good example of the role of structure and spontaneity and how they mix together. I'm interested in your engagement surveys and how your team are feeling about the work arrangements. Are you tracking that and what is it telling you?
So we do track, we do an annual engagement survey, and I think it's no surprises. I mean, that million who came to our website tells you that the popularity of it. But anecdotally, just in conversations with the team, the fact that if you're a Sydney-sider, or in fact any capital city, you can choose to go and live somewhere where housing is more affordable. You can choose to go and live closer to your family and help you out with childcare. That fundamentally changes your ability to focus at work. It fundamentally changes your ability to get more productivity in how you choose to work. And so we see that people are just really enjoying actually having the choice. And I think it's the choice that is what makes it so valuable. So if you're getting, you know, work done on your house, then great, you want to come into the office and avoid any of the jackhammering at home, you've got the option to do that. So I think it just means you get far more productivity because no one is forced to work in an environment that they do not want to be in.
Yeah. And just to jump in there, the academic research on this is very consistent with Susan's experience with Airbnb. So there's a good amount of research that has shown that remote employees are, in general, more productive. And a lot of times this COVID-19 phenomenon actually provided a natural experiment to sort of see, you know, people who are measuring productivity before and after we moved the same people to remote, what happened. In most cases, the people who were moved to remote were more productive and were more satisfied. Now, interestingly, they were also more stressed. So that's kind of interesting. They were more satisfied, but they were at the same time more stressed. So it's not that they're like relaxed, lazy at home, you know, watching TikTok, watching Netflix. They're focused.
It also suggests a really different role for leadership, I think, doesn't it? So you've got this very old-fashioned model of leadership, which is making sure that everyone's sitting in their office at the right time, that they're not leaving before 5 or 6 or whatever, and this really sort of micromanager view of leadership. But it seems like in this world that we're moving into, you need leaders that play a different role and have different function. Susan, when you're thinking about the leaders in your business, what are the attributes or skills you're really looking for there?
So you need exceptionally strong managers, but you also need to hire the right people. And I think we're very fortunate at Airbnb, just by the strength of the brand and the product, that we do have such a good talent pool that we pull from. And so if you hire extraordinary people, why would you not trust them to do the extraordinary things that you've asked them to do? And I found certainly in my experience that if you give people the ability to find their own path and do their own things, you'll just get far more out of them, far more creativity, far more innovation than if you say, hey, here's this thing that I need delivered. That's not to say you don't have parameters around deadlines and what products need to do and how things need to be executed. But for the most part, you've hired extraordinary people. And so they're capable of doing the role. I think the job of management and of good leaders is to then say, how can I help you to facilitate that? Who do you need to be introduced to in my network to help you get the answers or the data or this project going? And so it's more about just using your skills to help them deliver their work rather than telling them what they need to do.
So that's really the role of leadership, a bit like a guide, coach, enabler, rather than a monitoring type role, I'd say. Well, I want to talk to you because, you know, we've known for a long time that managing for outcomes enabling rather than controlling. There's quite a long history of people saying that it's a better way of doing things, but it's not common or typical. What do you think is getting in the way of that?
There is a tendency for many people to, when they move into leadership positions, to try to exert control. Oftentimes, people who are promoted into leadership positions are fairly conscientious. They're fairly experienced. They oftentimes think that they know the right way to do things. And the idea of cultivating and developing people so that they can lead themselves is not always something that comes naturally to people. And I think that's a core part of leadership development, and it has been for many years, but has only become more important in the technology-enabled world that we live in.
So, Susan, maybe we could talk a little bit about access to talent. I presume for an organization like yours, that's really important. And I'm wondering how much the hybrid work experience allows you to access that talent in a new way.
Well, I think the point is that to make the assumption that all talented people live in a capital city and the capital city in which you're headquartered seems illogical, and as it turns out, is illogical. So my view is I'd rather get the best person for the job. And if that means you're in a tiny country town, as long as you've got a decent Wi-Fi signal, you know, you're welcome to work with us. And I think that has helped us to find some extraordinary people. It's also helped us to retain extraordinary people. We had an example recently of a lawyer who said, you know, 14 years ago, it would not have been possible for me to move to my regional country town where I grew up and want to be with my family and be able to do this type of role. Just wasn't an option. And now it is. And, you know, I think the gains to that is extraordinary. So I think that certainly helps us. I mean, the other thing that helps us is it's hard not to love travel. It's hard not to love tech. And I think Airbnb does an amazing job in the communities that they're in. So I think that also certainly helps us to attract and to retain really strong talent.
But I assume the national regulations are struggling to keep up with this new world of work. Let's say you have a team member that says, I'm going to move to Bali and I'm going to do that work from there. Is that something you can accommodate, or is it still quite complicated?
So employees can actually live and work in over 170 countries, and that's for up to 90 days. And that's exactly to your point. It is really complex in relation to things like tax and visas. What we are actually doing is Airbnb is actually open sourcing a solution. So we're partnering with over 20 countries to offer remote work visas, and there's obviously more in the works. And all of that is about saying, if we can set it up for us, then other companies can use that same piece as well. And then you really allow that digital nomad piece to take off.
Just that seems to me really exciting, like that possibility of hiring people from anywhere, but also, as you mentioned, the tricky legal challenges. That's really the main barrier. But the idea that there are people around the world who are incredibly talented and also willing to work for very reasonable wages is really true. And for companies, I think that's one of the really big questions is, to what extent do you have a kind of hybrid model where people are in the office 3 days a week and there's sort of one office, or do you have a model that really is much more you can work from anywhere? And that has some really tricky cultural pieces and some really tricky legal pieces, but it also enables the ability to find really amazing people from around the world who are willing to work for quite reasonable wages. So I think in my mind, that's the really big structural question when it comes to employment.
I think the other thing to add on there, Will, is the fact that Airbnb is in over 200 countries in the world. What better way to access talent than from the countries where we actually are, who deeply understand the cultural nuances and what that market is looking for? And you can't get that when you're just headquartered out of a regional office. So for me, I think it's really strong from a business strategic point of view, and it also gives you access to the best talent in the world.
We're having this conversation in late 2022, and Elon Musk has just taken over Twitter. And he's told everyone to get back to the office and start exhibiting some of those old-fashioned behaviors. Susan, do you have a sense of how that's going to play out? You employ similar people, software developers, those sort of things. Have you got a sense of whether Elon's going to be successful at Twitter, or whether the Airbnb way is a better way to go?
Well, I think if you see the media reports, it looks like there's a fairly high increase in people potentially wanting to exit out of that. So, I mean, I can only speak for Airbnb, but certainly we found that it works for our team to date. If that was to change in the future, that would be something that would be done as part of, you know, an overall team consultation. It certainly wouldn't be at the decision of one person. And I think it would be highly unlikely that you would ever go back to a fully mandated in the office. We've seen that it works in a travel company during a global pandemic where travel wasn't allowed. And we've still had some of the strongest quarter on quarter growth coming through that. And we've had the IPO and we've released an extraordinary number of product refreshments. So for me, I just think the proof for us is in the pudding that it's worked to date. And I can't see why that would change shifting forward.
Will, what about you? Do you think Elon Musk's approach is going to be successful?
I wouldn't predict success. I'm looking forward to doing Elon's takeover of Twitter as a leadership case study, but I don't think it will be a study of to emulate exactly what to do. I think he's made a number of very, very bold, surprising decisions that at least go against a lot of the things that we typically teach. So it's a fascinating example, and I will be very surprised if he's successful. I hope he is, but I'm skeptical.
It's always really hard to get academics to predict something, so I'll take that as the closest we'll get. I do want to return to this issue about productivity because I'm really interested in the reported increase in productivity. One argument is just people working longer hours. They're checking their devices at 7, they're working all day, they're still online at 8:30. So it's not actually an increase in productivity, it's just working longer. Whereas some other people have argued that because you can have focus time and it's a bit more structured, people are able actually to work a bit more smarter. Susan, have you got a sense about the balance between those in your team?
Certainly, and I can talk about my own personal experience in this one. And it's certainly something that I think role modeling is really important in. My commute to the office was, in COVID, a 15-minute drive, in regular life, an hour and 15 minutes each way. And so the reality is yes, that is time that maybe you can make for a couple of phone calls, but it is pretty much dead time. I now use that time to go for a jog in the morning, which means from a mental health perspective, that's my meditation for the day. I get to listen to awful music. And then I'm starting at the same time I would start if I was going into the office, but I'm just in a much better headspace. And I think by encouraging all of the team to do that, so that time is their time, it's not time that they should be working. And it's also how you set up your internal meetings. We don't have any meetings that run outside of business hours. And in fact, we try and do some that finish a bit shorter so that if people have different bits and pieces to do, they can accommodate that. So it's all about setting up how people want to use that time. Having said that, if you want to pop out for 2 hours in the middle of the day to do an ocean swim because that's your thing and you would rather work from 7 to 9 in the evening, you are welcome to do that because that's what fits in for your lifestyle, with the caveat that everyone understands no one requires a response that's outside of business hours.
Okay, so that's putting some rules and some structure around it. And Will, your view on this productivity issue?
Yeah, so I would agree with you, Nick, that there's more and more people working evenings and weekends, but it's not necessarily that they're working more hours overall. So the studies that look at sort of how people are spending their time, it looks like they're basically working about the same number of hours, but they are taking interruptions in the 9 to 5 period to do various things and instead doing some of those same things in the evenings and the weekends. So there's a kind of blurring between your work life and your home life. That's been, very common for people like academics, like myself. That's always been the case. But now more and more people are having the challenge of really not feeling like they can turn off. I think that's one of the reasons why people experience more stress when they are remote work, even though they prefer it. They like that flexibility. But there is this kind of sense of, I always can be working, right? There, you always have access, the opportunity, the stimulant, the email, the text that's saying, there's something to be done. And that's something that when we were in the office from 9 to 5, that just wasn't possible. And you were forced to stop in a way that now no one's forced to stop.
So Susan, you gave us a great example about exercising, putting yourself in a good frame of mind and role modeling that behavior. But are you also conscious of the need to put some guidelines in place that allow people to structure the boundaries between work and life?
Definitely. I think this is where tech comes into its own. So things like you turn off your Slack notification. So it's automatically set up that when you don't want to receive notifications, you don't receive them. Likewise, we have across the office, for those who want to partake, meeting-free Wednesday. So everyone knows that on Wednesday, you've got time to do that really deep dive thinking work. We also do things, as I said, about where you schedule meetings to make sure that they're not kind of impeding. We regularly seek feedback on what day is best for our all hands, what time is most suited to people, just so, we can work out where it's most suited. So you just do have to put in some guardrails on how you kind of help that. And likewise for holidays, we also say, switch off all of the notifications on your work email and on your Slack. You're on PTO. If it's urgent, there's an expectation that you'll pick up the phone and call. Because also, if you're not prepared to pick up the phone and call someone, it's not really that urgent. So that, again, I think just helps to really make sure that that time is precious and you get that time to recharge. I think the other thing that Airbnb is very good at is we have company-wide global days off that they will just pop in. So we've got one coming up on Monday. And that's also just a nice way of knowing that the whole company is offline. And that day, particularly in a global organization, the public holiday here is not a public holiday in the States. So having that global day off means you know you've got a whole day where that's a genuine, nothing is coming in, there's no pings. And it's amazing what that does for just company morale and getting people re-energized.
So, Will, it seems that Airbnb as an organization has been quite thoughtful and it's thought about helping employees manage this online, offline world. But there are plenty of organizations where that's not necessarily the case. How should organizations be thinking about helping their employees manage that, the blurring between work life and private life?
I think that one of the underlying challenges is to what extent a company wants to be directive about that versus to say, oh, if you want to work in the evenings and weekends, it's up to you. So, you know, I remember with my PhD advisor, he said to me very much tongue in cheek, you have wonderful flexibility as an academic. You can work whatever, 60 hours a week, wherever and whenever you want. So I think that's a question of to what extent do you somehow have some sense of when people are overloaded, checking in with them, and then taking off some of the gas, right? Taking off some of the pressure. And that's sometimes harder to do in a virtual context to sort of understand, are people overloaded or not? And that requires sort of basically having check-ins with people. So if you aren't already doing it already, this means you need to be having, for example, weekly one-on-ones with your people to keep that relationship warm when you can't just pop by the office with each other.
You can also think of a situation where junior people in an organization feel like they just have to keep working and there's not really a clocking off time or those type of things. And it could lead to burnout and quite challenging situations. Do you think we're likely to see an increase of burnout and those type of things across organizations?
I do. Yeah. I think you're likely to see probably more burnout for a couple of reasons. One is I think people are more stressed. One, there's the lack of blurring. There's also the loneliness component for people who are completely remote. On the other hand, despite that, I think most people prefer the option of working from home. It's not just I think that. The empirical results are astounding. Almost everybody wants it, and especially younger people, and especially women. For them, it's as near to universal as you can get, want that option, want that flexibility. So yes, I don't think it's necessarily all, you know, roses, but it is, in general, most people find it a more desirable configuration for their lives, that flexibility.
Okay, so Susan, you've spoken about how Airbnb as an organization has really designed the relationship between the virtual and the office, and I think that's really interesting. And it sort of goes to this broader point that Airbnb is a design-led organization, and all of us who've used the product will have a bit of a sense of that. But I'm wondering, where is this workforce and workplace design happening? Is it corporate headquarters, or are there different parts of the business being asked to create a model that works for them? How does that play out across the organization?
It's a combination of both. So the overall policy is obviously done at a global level, and that's done in consultation with employees to understand what they actually do want. And part of that is then also done at a country level. And the reason being is because you've got cultural nuance, you've got different ways that people work, you've got different housing environments. And so by giving that flexibility to say, here's the overarching policy, and then allowing people to work out what works best in their region. I think the other thing is we've got an incredibly strong group of country directors right across the world. So being able to then share and learn from each other about, oh, you've implemented that. That's really interesting. Let's try that here. And then it's always an iterative process. So there's not a set and forget, this is how we're going to do it. It's always, you get new people on board, you know, macro environment changes. It's about continually kind of saying, is this working best for us at the moment? How do we keep it making sure that it's working for everyone?
So I'm going to wrap things up now just by asking you to think forward a little bit and maybe just tell us, you know, 5 years from now, what you think work is going to look like and what you're excited about in that. So maybe, Susan, we can start with you.
in my dream state, I'm in a self-driving car, which means I can do work and I can commute to wherever I would like. But I don't think it will be that different to what we're seeing at somewhere like Airbnb today. I think it will just be far more widespread, because as the need for strong talent and that competition gets harder, people are just going to have to allow humans to live like humans, which I think then means that we'll see more companies doing a similar program.
And Will, what are you excited about?
Yeah, so I mean, I love the idea of, I think, what Airbnb is accomplishing and enabling, which is for people to work in a variety of cool places, to move around, this digital nomad thing. I think right now it's a very exotic phenomenon, but I think it would be interesting and quite plausible that in the next 5 years, more and more people are going to be working from distance. I think you're going to see probably fewer people live in cities, which is interesting. I mean, I think there's going to be a gradual move away from cities, which are so expensive, towards now people living more and more, I think, in rural type areas. I think it's going to be a modest shift, but I would expect that. There's probably, I think, the really interesting thing in the next 5 years is going to be how many companies go beyond hybrid work. So right now, hybrid work is the safe option, where, and it's sort of this becoming the sort of the new normal, where you go into the office 2 or 3 days a week, you work from home 2 or 3 days a week. I'm very curious about in the next 5, 10, 15 years, whether or not you're going to move to an increasingly remote workforce where, you know, Nick, you talked about people from Bali. Are you going to hire people like that? I don't know the answer to that, but it's a set of experiments I'm looking forward to seeing.
Okay, great. Well, I've really enjoyed the conversation. I think it's given us a huge amount to think about and something that we're going to be dealing with for the next little while. Susan, thanks so much for sharing the Airbnb story, and great to reconnect with you. And Will, thanks so much for your input.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nick. Thanks, Susan.
Thank you for joining us for AGSM's The Business of Work, The Great Reorganization. Want to learn more about what organizations can do to attract and retain talent? Head to our website to check out the UNSW research discussed on today's podcast. Just search The Business of Podcast online, or drop us a line to suggest future topics at brand@agsm.edu.au. New to The Business of Leadership? There is a whole catalogue of back episodes for you to explore, from talking to the CEO of Sydney FC on how to pivot business plans fast, to how to engineer a climate-friendly business into the future. You can check out all the conversations today. Please share, rate and review, and subscribe to AGSM's Leadership Podcast on your favourite podcast platform, and look out for future episodes. In the meantime, you can follow AGSM at UNSW Business School on LinkedIn and Facebook for more industry insights for an accelerating world. Or find us at agsm.edu.au.